done it a bunch of times, but it could. Yeah, so who knows whether we'll even need this one, but I like this one. I always like this one. Well, it's hard to know. please stand as we sing together number 643, God of Day and God of Darkness, number 643.
Gather finally on a beautiful sunny day. We gather as the Lord's people, united in our common baptism, to be a priestly people, to offer praise and homage to our God. So it is with confidence that we begin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
In the words of St. Paul, you who have been made holy in Christ Jesus, you who have been called to be saints, with all of those who call upon the name of the Lord in every place, grace and peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
And as we begin our Eucharist, once again, we seek the Lord's mercy and forgiveness. Lord God, may our love be patient, kind, not jealous. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, may our love not be rude, not self-seeking, not quick-tempered. Christ, have mercy. Let our love rejoice with the truth, bear all things, hope all things, endure all things. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sin, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world.
Let us pray. Almighty God, make our ears attentive to the voice of Jesus, and make our hearts generous in answering his call. Take fear and anxiety away from us, and awaken within us the faith that saves. Let us leave behind all that hinders us, so as to walk surely in the path of the gospel. We pray this through our Lord Jesus Christ, the one who died, who rose, and who lives with you in unity of the Spirit, one God forever and ever. The first reading is taken from the Old Testament Book of Wisdom, and it's a beautiful reading that reminds us that God's judgment is lenient. God is just, but God is loving and is not out to get us. The second reading is briefly from a letter to the Romans, and Paul reminds us that it is the Holy Spirit who prays within us, even with unutterable groanings, even that words can't describe. In the gospel reading today, Jesus will once again speak in parables, which invite us into the story to find ourselves. They're interesting, but pay attention to the ending of the gospel, where the wording seems to get a whole lot more threatening.
Reading from the Book of Wisdom. There is no God besides you who have the care of all, that you need show you have not unjustly condemned. For your might is the source of justice. Your mastery over all things makes you lenient to all. For you show your might when the perfection of your power is disbelieved. And in those who know you, you rebuke temerity. But though you are master of might, you judge with clemency, and with much lenience you govern us. Ill attends you. And you taught your people by these deeds that those who are just must be kind. And you gave your children good ground for hope that you would permit repentance for their sins. The word of the Lord.
Is near to the one.
spring up as the water from the earth. Justice shall reign from the heavens. Lord, let us see. Justice shall walk in his pathways. Salvation, the gift that he brings. Lord, let us see your kindness. Lord, let us see.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, the Spirit comes to the aid of our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes with inexpressible groanings. And the one who searches hearts knows what is the intention of the Spirit, because he intercedes for the holy ones according to God's will. The word of the Lord.
The strength of your word, send us to be your disciples, to bring all the world to the joy of your kingdom.
From the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus proposed another parable to the crowds, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be likened to a man who sowed good seed in his field. While everyone was asleep, his enemy had sowed weeds all through the wheat and then went off. When the crop grew and bore fruit, the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said, 'Man, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where have the weeds come from?' And he answered, 'Me has done this.' And his slaves said to him, 'Do you want us to go pull them up?' But he replied, 'No, if you pull up the weeds, you might uproot the wheat as well. Let them grow together until harvest. And then at harvest time, I will say to the harvesters, first collect the weeds and tie them in bundles for burning, but gather that to my barn.' All these things Jesus spoke to the crowds in parables. He spoke to them only in parables, to fulfill what had been said through the prophet, I will open my mouth in parables. I will announce what laid hidden from the foundation of the world. And then, dismissing the crowds, he went into the house. And his disciples approached him, and they said, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." And he said to them in reply, "He who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed, the children of the kingdom, are the children of the evil one. And the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are the angels. And just as we collect burned up with fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all who cause others to sin and all evildoers. They will throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. And then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Whoever has ears ought to hear." The Gospel of the Lord.
There are so many places in the Gospel where we find that Jesus is compassionate, merciful, non-judgmental. You think of the story of the prodigal son. Kid wastes the family fortune, then comes back, and the father doesn't care. He just has his boy back and receives him. You think of the woman caught in adultery. She could have been stoned to death, and Jesus says, "Has no one condemned you?" "No, Lord, no one. Then neither shall I. Go your way, sin no more." Peter asks, "How often should I forgive my brother if he sins against me? 7 times? Jesus says, 70 times 7. Try that, Peter. He says, "There was a woman of the city came." I mean, she was a prostitute, and she wipes the feet of Jesus at a meal. And everybody's scandalized that a prostitute is touching Jesus. And he says, "Because she has loved much, much is forgiven of her." On the cross, even Jesus says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And he turns to somebody else crucified and says, "This day you'll be with me in paradise." There's just loads of expressions like this of the mercy of God, which makes me wonder at times about the language of the Gospel today at the end. "They'll be put into bundles for burning. Some will be thrown into a fiery furnace. There will be wailing and grinding of teeth." Next Sunday, it'll repeat this again of being thrown into an eternal fire. Most of us grew up with a lot of this, with visions of hell. Flames we're going to be licking at our heels. And it's kind of a gruesome picture of what the end might be. I think the grim words of Jesus here just show us that judgment is a reality and that we have to be responsible for what we did in life. But the great thing, I think, is that Jesus gave us freedom. And what will happen to us finally is not that God wants to condemn us to hell or bring us to heaven, but make us accountable for what we have done with our own human freedom. I'm not sure about all the imagery here of burning and all that. It was the Old Testament to say, punishment for sinners, fire. They could have just as soon said, punishment for sinners, you're in a freezer for the rest of your life, or something. It's just a way, it's imagination, it's a kind of poetic license. It's visionary kinds of language. And Jesus was a man of his own day, and he picked up that language that was used. I think what happens to us is we get caught up in the particulars of it, whether or not there's hell or whether or not we're going to toast like marshmallows, you know, for eternity. I doubt if that is the case of a loving God who wants that. Some people say there ought to be something like hell, because sometimes there are crimes that are so terrible that there ought to be a place like that, a sense of punishment. You think of the millions who suffered under Stalin and Hitler, and what's going on in Ukraine today, and Sudan, and Ethiopia. I mean, just people hanging on to their power and don't care kinds of I think if there is some kind of a hell, it's for people who stay in their selfishness, who stay in their control of power and don't want any kind of a change. Some people don't want to change. It was like this guy, he was reading, he said, I was reading the other day that drinking a lot of alcohol is bad for your health. So he said, I have decided after that, that now I am going to give up reading. This is the inability to change. Or what happens? They just this. Lewis, the writer, at one time said, "The door in hell, the inside." Not that God locked the outside door and said, I want you condemned to hell. It's a judgment that finally says, you have been so consistent. Anything, you have condemned yourself to some kind of a wicked afterlife. Whether or not that includes flames and fires and all of that, those are the particulars about which we know very, very little and shouldn't get caught up on it. It's a question of judgment and responsibility for human freedom. The Catholic Church has never said that we know that there is anybody for sure in hell, or if it exists. Well, a lot of people do. I mean, I've been told to my face that I am going to go to hell. I have no chance of getting into heaven. And I said it was some kind of a very fundamentalist Christian, and he said, well, because you're a Catholic. And I said, that's it. You're not the right kind of Christian. So that's my future. I won't tell you what I said to this guy in return. But, you know, we do play this game at times. You know, people condemned to hell. And even in the Catholic tradition, we never said we were sure that everybody went to hell, but we gave the impression sometimes that if you didn't measure up to Catholicism, you know, you had a pretty shaky future. I don't know if you ever you heard of, there's a spiritual writer. She's a Benedictine nun who's been writing on spirituality for decades now. Sister Joan Chichester, she's a very insightful writer. She's well in her 80s now, and she tells a story about when she was growing up. She was a little girl in grade school. Her mother was a devout Roman Catholic, and her father was a devout Presbyterian. And Joan was in school one day. She came home, and mother said, well, what did you learn today? And she said, the sister said that only Catholics can go to heaven. Everybody else is doomed. The mother said, what did you think about sister saying that? Said, oh, sister's wrong on that. And mother said, how do you know that sister is in error? How do you know she's wrong? And Joan said, sister never met daddy. And that level of, I think, mercy and compassion we know is, I mean, what do you think then it is with Almighty God? Fire in hell is imagery. It's imaginative, it's mythical, it's descriptive, but we should not turn it into factual language. We just don't know. We've been influenced by, you know, if you've ever read Dante and his circles of hell, it's very gruesome. If you've seen the Sistine Chapel at times with the judgment of the wicked, we all hope to go to the bosom of Abraham, but if we're not, we're going to be in some kind of a pit. Is hell eternal? Jesus talks about eternal fire, but I think he was picking up the language of his day. Why would a loving God want to have people toasting like hot dogs for an eternity? It's hard to figure that one out. I wonder at times if it was the church's way of keeping people on the straight and narrow to say, this is the end. I'm not denying that there's going to be judgment, no responsibility, or some kind of a future, even with difficulty. We Catholics turned purgatory into a mini hell, didn't we? You're going to go to purgatory and roast for a while, but it'd end, and somehow you could get out. The earliest church never talked about punishment in anything like purgatory. They talked about purification, that maybe at the end of life, we didn't really come to the full realization of who we are as human beings, and God's grace can still touch us after our death and help us to grow into the fullness of the humanity we are, to let our selfishness go, our ego go, and all of that. Will it be difficult? Will there be suffering in purgatory? Think of how difficult it is right now to give up your egocentric nature or your wants and me first and all of that. There's a story of a samurai master. He was a swordsman, a great warrior and all of that. And he came to a Zen master one day. And he said, "Master, teach me the meaning of hell and heaven." And the master said, "Me teach a dumbbell like you? Somebody as stupid as you? You have mush between your ears. I mean, I could teach a four-year-old and I'd get a better response. I don't deal with dumbbells like you. You're so out of tune and touch. I mean, why aren't you in an insane asylum?" And the samurai said, "I don't care if he's a holy man. Nobody speaks to me that way." And he took out his sword, raised it up, and the Zen master said, "And that is hell." And the samurai realized it, and he fell at the knees of the master, and he said, "You did teach me. Right now my heart is just overflowing with peace and love and goodness at you." And the master said, "And that is heaven." And the reason I say that is I'm more and more concerned these days, not so much about fire and hell and purgatory. I leave that. We don't know. What I am concerned about more and more is our ability to create our own hells or heavens here on earth. We have human freedom, and we can make those kinds of decisions. And you read the paper, the television, anything today, you see stuff that is going on in this world that is so heinous, it is so horrible, that we can hardly stand it. And yet at other times you look at it and you see the goodness of people who are trying to make something worthwhile out of life. As T.S. Eliot, the writer, once said, "We are kin to the angels and the alley cats." Some days you think you're really good, and then other days there's not much you can put past yourself. And that's where we are with this question of whether or not that we're going to be bundled up and burned and all that kind of stuff. The reality of it is that God is merciful and loving, and that kind of grace can continue even after death. That we have the ability and the choices in this life to make our own heavens or hells. I'll leave you with this little story. There was a woman who was dying of cancer, and her pastor came to her and said, "Do you have any last requests, anything know, you'd like. She said, yes, when I'm in the casket, I want you to put a fork into my hand. Pastor, okay, but what's this about? She said, every time I went to a parish dinner, and you'd sit down, you had this meal, and people were waiting on you and all this. Usually it was the women who were serving and waiting. She said somebody would come up and pick up the plate and say, save your fork. There's some really good dessert coming. And this woman knew if the fork was in her hand, in her casket, it was a way of saying she knew something good was still coming. So folks, maybe that's the lesson for the day. Hold on to your fork. It's time for our creed. This is the creed shared by over a billion Catholics throughout the world on a day like today. It is our formula of faith. Codifies. It puts together what we believe and what we stand by. I want to read parts of it to you when I pause. If you accept that, I want you to say, I do. Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord?
I do.
Do you believe that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried? Do you believe that Jesus ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, and from there he will come to judge the living and the dead?
I do.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? So do I. This is our faith, which we proudly proclaim.
And so let us pray. For the church, that we may allow the good seed of the gospel to take root within us and bring forth a harvest of virtue and living proofs the reign of God among us. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear.
For patience, that we may not judge one another, but rather be open to the work that God is doing within each of us that will be revealed in God's time. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a deepening of prayer, that we may offer our discontent and pain, our yearnings to God honestly, and allow the Spirit to intercede for us. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who are bound by hatred and resentment, that the Spirit will cultivate forgiveness and compassion within hearts, and wither the seeds of the evil one that yield revenge and violence. We pray to the Lord. And for each of us, that with the leaven of compassion and justice in our society, so that the weeds of racism and oppression may be stifled, we pray to the Lord.
Lord.
And we pray for all those who are suffering from floods and fires, from famine and droughts, that God will protect people, lands, and harvests, that all may be safe in the coming weeks and months. We pray to the Lord. And as always, we pray for those who are sick, for you yourself, if you're not well, those who care for the sick each day, in a special way, Betty Thresher, Kelly O'Brien, Teresa. May the Spirit come to their aid in their weakness and cover them with its healing wings. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for our dearly departed, today we remember in a special way James and Kathleen Sorahan, Robert and Jean Mitnacht, Jules Bontempi, Slovinda Dersini, and Annunziata de Sosa, that with all the righteous, they may shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. We pray to the Lord. And lastly, in silence, for the things, the people that are closest to your heart this morning. Pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
O God, help your church to live in faithfulness and in love, always attentive to the signs of the times, and full of tenderness and understanding toward the most fragile of your children. We pray it through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated, everyone. At the beginning of each section of pews, you'll find a basket, a wicker basket, and if you kind of pass that around and back, our ushers could collect it, and that's for our collection. Your generosity really keeps the shrine alive, so we thank you in advance for that.
Place these simple gifts of bread and wine upon the altar. They are symbols of our own self-offering. As the bread and wine will be changed into the body and blood of Christ, our prayer is that our lives also may be more changed into the life of Christ. So with this in mind, I ask you to pray now that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God the Almighty. Almighty God, grant that we who worship Christ in this Eucharist may reverence him by helping the needy of the world. Build up your church by deepening within us the life lived according to the gospel. Teach us to imitate your unfailing kindness and to build up Christ's body, the church. As always, we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is true. truly right and just, it is our duty, it is our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you praise. For you have given us Jesus Christ as Lord and Redeemer. Jesus always showed compassion for children and for the poor, for the sick and for sinners. Jesus became a neighbor to the oppressed and the afflicted. By word and deed, he announced to the world that you are a loving God and that you care for all of your daughters and sons. And so, with all the angels and saints, we exalt and bless your name and sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Be glorified, Almighty God, for you are the one who loves the human race, and you always walk with us on the journey of life. And blessed indeed is Jesus, who is present here this morning in our midst, for we have come to this grotto gathered by his word and love. And when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, Jesus opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, God most merciful, we send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. For on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread. He said the blessing. He broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In the same way, when supper was ended, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and praise. Gave the cup to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord.
Therefore, God most holy, we celebrate this memorial of Christ our Savior, the Christ you led to the passion and death of the cross, but also who is raised in the glory of the resurrection. Jesus, who is now seated at your right hand. And we proclaim the work of your love until Jesus comes again. And in the interim, we offer you this bread of life and this cup of blessing. We ask you to look with favor on our offering, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice given to us, and grant by the power of the Spirit of your love that we may be counted now and until the day of eternity amongst the members of the body of Christ. Bring your church, Lord God, to a fuller faith, hope, and love, together with our Pope, with our bishop, and the entire people you have made your own. Open our eyes to the needs of our brothers and sisters. Inspire in us words and actions to comfort those who labor and are burdened. Make us serve these people truly after the example of Christ and his command. And may your church stand as a living witness to truth, to freedom, to peace, and to justice, that all people may be raised up to a new hope. And we ask you to be mindful of our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the peace of Christ, and all the dead whose faith is known to you alone. Admit these good people to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. And grant also to us that when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we too may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever, in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with the apostles, the martyrs, and all the saints. We shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ the Lord. Through him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen. 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 Amen.
The singing of the great Amen is a sign we know we have been accepted, for we have associated our offering with the gift of infinite worth, the Lord Jesus Christ. This gives us confidence to continue to pray in the words and in the spirit that our Savior gave us. Our Father, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation. Yes, deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our time. In your loving kindness, free us from the selfishness which leads us to sin. Help us to cope with all undue anxiety as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Lord Jesus, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, peace is my gift." Do not look upon our sins nor our failings, but rather look upon the faith, the hope, and the love of this community, which gathers here in your name this morning. And in your loving kindness, grant to all of us the peace and the unity of your kingdom, where you are now living and reigning forever and ever. And may the peace of the Lord be with you all. Let's be at peace with one another. If anyone has trouble walking, just stay in your place, and at the end of communion, raise your hand, and we shall bring communion to you. This is the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is Jesus, our risen Lord, who has told us, "The one who comes to me will never hunger, the The one who believes in me will never thirst. So happy are we who are called to this meal. Lord, you should enter into my room. Only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring all who receive it unto everlasting life.
First communion song is number 328, Ubi Caritas, number 328.
In need, make us your mercy for the saints of God to sing eternal praise. Ubi caritas, est fera, Deus tibi est, Deus tibi est.
Our second communion song is number 455, Send Us Your Spirit, number 455.
Send us your spirit, O Lord. Evening enfolds us and holds us too near. Wake the morning light, make our living bright. Shine on our darkness, O Lord. Hold us with mercy, O Lord. Sorrow has spoken, has broken. Shadows have crowded our sight. Give us hearts that see, set our loving free. Hear us and help us, O Lord. Send us good summer, O Lord. Winters have chilled us and stilled us too long. Give us love's own fire, be our true desire. Send us your spirit, O Lord.
announcements. As always, the cafe is open with lots of good things to eat. And you're most welcome to go there, eat inside, outside. There's also the gift shop that's there and ready for you. As always, on these Sundays at 3 o'clock, we have rosary and benediction of the Blessed Sacrament. I think we may be inside this afternoon if you're here, but we will have the prayer. You're most welcome. And you may have seen some signs in August 12th, we're having a fundraiser for the shrine. It's an evening up at Montfort House, live music, very good wines, foods, and the tickets are $70 a person. It's not for everybody to have it. It's a big help. And the tickets could be bought at the gift shop or online. But it's Saturday, August 12th, and you might keep that in mind. And then just the last thing, Father Richard has been giving lectures these Tuesday evenings in July, and the last one will be this coming Tuesday, July 5th. And it's right in the Grotto Chapel from 7 to 8. Everybody's welcome. Don't need a reservation. The topic this time almost flows right from today's readings. It is afterlife, hell, purgatory, heaven. That's the title. I got to tell you one quick story, though, about these things. There was a wonderful daughter of wisdom, our sister Amy Thibodeau, who used to work here. She started off her life as a cook, became an alcoholic counselor sans pareil, but she started off as a cook. And in those days, the Mother Superior could tell you all kinds of nonsense and yelled at everybody and blah, blah, blah. And Amy had such good sense. She was a saint in the end. Anyway, God forgive me, Mother Superior would be yelling at her and this and that and all of that. And Amy used to say, "Oh, all this and hell besides."
Okay, let's pray. Almighty God, keep us from pettiness. Let us be large in thought, word, and deed. May we put away all pretenses and meet each other without prejudice. Teach us to put in our better impulses, straightforward, unafraid. Show us that the little things in life create difficulties, but in the big things, we are one. And, O Lord, let us not forget to be kind. As always, we pray this through Christ our Lord. May God's light encircle you. May God's love enfold you. May God's peace encourage you. May God's presence enrich you. We ask all of this in the name of the one who is our Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You're a Eucharistic people. You are now sent forth to love and to serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our recessional song is number 559. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven. Number 559.
Praise my soul, the King of Heaven. To his feet thy truth.